This is radio TV phono nut, and about 10 or 12 years ago, the late Chris Cuff did a review on one of these Crosley Collegiate record players, and he gave it high marks. And I've always wanted to get my hands on one of these just to play with, but the problem was I'm cheap and I didn't want to pay much money for one. And when these always came up for sale, they always seemed to go for more money than your average Crosley. Well, one finally turned up on the Goodwill auction site that I could get for a reasonable price, including shipping, so I jumped on it. This does appear to be in a decent looking plastic case, and by the way, I found out that this is a replica of a 1960s Bush record player that was available in the UK. Of course, the Bush record player will be about 1,000 times better than this, and I'd like to get my hands on one, but unfortunately those UK issued record players don't show up that much here in the United States, and shipping one here from the UK would probably be prohibitive. So yeah, we have a nice plastic case here, and we have a nice carry handle. And unlike many Crosleys, this one actually has a storage compartment to hold the wall wart power supply and the USB cable and the auxiliary cable. Yes, you can connect this to your computer and use it for copying records, but you know, I would think if you're going to go to the trouble of copying your records, you'd want to get a little bit better turntable and such than using one of these little portables like this. Although I will say the sound quality on this is, it's certainly not high fidelity, but it's better than the average Crosley with your ceramic cartridge in it. And before I say any more, the problem with ceramic cartridge equipped Crosleys is not so much the fact that they use a ceramic cartridge, it's the fact that the amplifiers are poorly designed and not properly impedance matched to the cartridge, and the speakers are crap too, so that's where your problem comes in. Back in the day, they had some mighty fine sounding record players that used ceramic cartridges, but those were well designed. But even though this is better than your typical Crosley Cruiser, this thing still has some shortcomings. I wasn't even going to do a video on this, but I decided I would go ahead and do a video, so let me explain the shortcomings this thing has. As you can see, this is our turntable mechanism, and it's a little bit fancier looking than the average Crosley turntable, but underneath it's still the same crappy mechanism for the most part is what you'd see in your typical Crosley or Victrola or any other modern day record player. The main thing that distinguishes this one apart from your average mechanism is this one does have a Audio-Technica 3600 magnetic cartridge, and it does have an adjustable counterweight here. I have it backed out all the way to the as far as it'll go to give us the least amount of weight, but even at that, this thing tracks at about 6 grams, while the recommended tracking pressure range for this Audio-Technica cartridge is in the 2.5 to 3.5 gram range. Now this still doesn't bottom out the cantilever, but in my opinion it's still tracking a bit too high for what it is. Another shortcoming this thing has is the auto stop feature. Now I believe the newer versions of this had an auto stop defeat switch, as do most other record players with this type of mechanism, but this particular tone arm was turning off the motor before the end of the record. Well, normally there's a screw you can adjust on the auto stop mechanism to take care of that problem, but in this case the screw didn't even have enough range, the adjustment didn't have enough range, and the reason for that is they mounted the auto stop mechanism to the wrong position on the tone arm. And the way they mounted it to the tone arm was stuck it to the tone arm and then melted it in place. I thought GE only did stuff like that back in the 60s. I guess the Chinese must have picked up something from GE. But anyway, I was afraid to try and remove that tone arm auto stop mechanism because of fear of breaking something, so I just simply snipped off the piece of plastic that controls the auto stop. Now the motor still does not run when the tone arm is on its rest. It starts whenever we move the tone arm towards the record, but when the tone arm reaches the end of the record, the turntable will just continue to spin until you pick up the tone arm and move it back to its rest. But that's no big deal for me. I mean, if you're somebody that's prone to falling asleep while the record player is playing, that might be an issue, but I don't plan on falling asleep while my record player is playing, so that's not going to be a problem. When I got this, the belt had fallen off of the turntable platter. And I'll just go ahead and tell you, when a belt falls off of the turntable platter, you need to replace the belt, because that means the belt has stretched and it needs to be replaced. But I put the belt back on long enough to hear the record player operate, and I went and ordered a new belt off of a gentleman on eBay. I got a PRB belt, which I think is a bit better than the crappy belts from China that came on these. Well, as far as I know, the PRB belts may have come from China too, but they look a little more substantial than what's typically on these. And then once we replace the belt, I'll probably have to adjust the speed, and I also need to tighten down this head shell. It's loose, as you can see. I hope it's just a case of the screw has worked loose and that the hole is not stripped out. And a Crosley Cruiser record player that I recently gutted and turned it into a tool case. At least they're good for something. Okay, I was able to tighten the screw on the head shell, but this tone arm, you know, it's still kind of wobbly at the back, which is about normal for these types of cheap tone arms, and there's really nothing I can do about that. All right, let's change the belt, and we need to pop off this little E-clip, making sure not to let it fly across the room. And the way you know your belt is worn out is when it stretches and will no longer stay tight around the inner rim of the turntable. If the belt was good, I should be able to flip this turntable right side up and the belt should stay in place. As you can see, that didn't happen with this belt. Okay, I put a drop of oil on the top motor bushing, cleaned the motor pulley, cleaned all the old grease off of the center spindle and re-lubricated it, and now we're ready to put the new belt in place. And I also cleaned the inner rim of the platter with isopropyl alcohol. And as you can tell, this new belt fits tightly around the inner rim. So now we stretch the belt over this little peg here, place the platter back on so that the motor pulley falls within the triangle here, and work the platter back and forth a few times. Then you'll hear the belt snap off of the peg, and then it should orient itself onto the motor pulley. And then once you verify proper operation, put the E-clip back on and you're all set. Alright, I just checked our speed and it's way fast, which is not uncommon when you replace the belt. You usually have to adjust the speed. Oftentimes when the old belt starts to wear out, the turntable speed will change, and then people who know how to do it will go inside and tweak the pots, and then whenever you put a new belt on it, then it's all out of whack. So yeah, we need to go back in here and adjust that. And to get this apart, you have to remove these two screws at the rear of the motor board, these two screws up here holding this gray piece in place. Then you slide that back, and then there'll be two more screws on the front of the motor board that you have to remove to lift off, just in order to lift off the motor board. This is from 2012 and it says, "Caution, risk of electric shock, do not open." Well, challenge accepted, because the maximum voltage in here is 12 volts. I find that very comical. Alright, here's the amplifier board, and I suspect the majority of the circuitry on here is for the USB capability. Not something I'd want to try to service. You know, this is one area where the older tube and through hole solid state stuff has the advantage. You can actually repair that stuff without much difficulty, and often with off the shelf parts, this crap here is really not meant to be repaired. And you can see that's one of the speakers. It's got two of them. This is a stereo unit, and those speakers are a bit more substantial than what you normally see in a 21st century portable record player. And it looks like we got a couple of bass ports here, for whatever that's worth. All right, here's the auto stop piece that I had to break off right here. And you see how they melted it in place to hold it on the tone arm, which means there's no real way I can get that off. Some of the later models had the tone arm wiring running out here and then used a screw to hold the auto stop mechanism in place. Had they done that on this one, I could have been able to change that one's position and maybe get it to work right, but like I said, I couldn't, so I didn't, so I cut off this piece, and now there's no auto stop, which is fine with me. And I think the reason our speed is running fast is because the belt didn't fully engage on the pulley properly. It's up around the top lip of the pulley, which is making it run fast. So we need to correct that and then recheck our speed and adjust as needed. Yep, that's exactly what happened. Okay, now it's a little slow, which is more expectable. All right, the way you do this, on the bottom of the motor, you'll notice two holes, one marked L, one marked H. The L is for 33 RPM, H is for 45 RPM. And then to do 78 RPM, there's a potentiometer on the little circuit board where the connector is for the turntable mechanism. That does 78. You'll need a small screwdriver like this, flathead screwdriver. You need to do the 33 first because the other two speeds center around 33. 33 is the master speed, so do 33 first, then do 45, and then do 78. Now be careful not to let your screwdriver touch the outer case of the motor, because it'll run wide open. If you do, it won't damage anything. It'll just cause the motor to run wide open. And what you want to do is adjust the, for 33, you adjust so the dots, I like to pitch them just a little bit fast. That way that will compensate for the weight of the record and any tone arm drag that happens to be present. And then do the same thing for 45 and then for 78. Okay, this looks like the L pot for 33. This looks like H for 45. Now there is a rubber gasket here that you'll have to protrude through. They put that there to keep dust and debris out of the motor. And then the little pot you see there is for 78. Okay, in this case I'm having to use a plastic diddle stick with a flat blade on it, which is better because there's no chance of me shorting anything out. At least on this one, they have metal riveted to plastic, and we're screwing into metal, not cheap MDF or cardboard that's gonna wallow out and crumble apart on us. So yeah, I will give it to them that they did try on this one, but they should have gone a bit further. Okay, we're back together, and it looks like the bottom's fixing to fall out. It seems like every afternoon we've been getting these sudden afternoon little thunderstorms. But before that happens, hopefully before that happens, let's talk about needles a minute. The needle that comes on this is for playing LPs and 45s only. There is a needle available for playing 78s, which is 3 mm in diameter. Learn from my mistake. Do not order the Fansteel brand needle. I ordered that particular needle for one of my other turntables that I modified for 78. It was tracking within the 2.5 to 3.5 gram range, and the cantilever bottomed out. So I ordered a needle from LP Gear, which is supposed to be made in Japan. I think the Fansteel ones are made in Switzerland. I have no idea who makes the ones for LP Gear, but I took a chance and ordered that one for my other turntable, and it seems to do just fine. The cantilever does not bottom out. Well, that's been several months ago, Well, I looked and was going to order a 78 needle for this thing, but they now want $38 plus shipping and tax, which by the time we paid all that, we'd probably be looking at around 50 bucks for a 3 mil needle for this portable record player. And I just don't know that I'm willing to spend 50 bucks for a needle just to have the capability of playing 78s on this, especially whenever I have other portable record players, mainly classroom style and some older kiddie style tube record players with the LP78 flip stylus that I can play my 78s on and probably get better fidelity out of them than what I would get out of this thing. So this one's probably going to be used for 33 and 45. Now, as far as the tracking pressure being too much, I could affix additional weights back here, but it would look tacky, and I just really don't want to do that. This is not something that I'm going to be playing my pristine valuable records on. So as long as the cantilever don't bottom out, I'm really not too concerned about it. We'll just play our common and beat up LPs and 45s on this and go with it. Like I said, I do like the looks of this. They did put some effort into it, but they should have put a little more effort into it. All right, after the rain gets out of here, we'll play some records on this and see how it sounds, or hear how it sounds. All right, here's an LP.
Stop kicking.
Hadn't got a lot of volume, but it'll do for personal use. All right, here's a 45. I actually get a little hint of bass out of this one. Here's a 78. This is one of those with two songs to a side, so there's a play a little better with an LP needle than a standard 78 will. Another feature I wish they would have added to this was a cueing lever. It's funny, a Crosley Cruiser has a cueing lever, but this one, that's supposed to be a more upscale model, does not have a cueing lever. But yeah, I'll probably keep it around here until I get tired of looking at it, and then it'll go up on Facebook Marketplace for 35 bucks to cover what I paid for the thing plus the belt, and then I will sit around and get pissed when nobody serious contacts me about buying it, and all I get are the scam emails, you know, the identity theft scammers. The one I get a lot of, can pick up today or can pick up tomorrow, text me at some out-of-state phone number, and then whenever you look at their Facebook profile, it's either a blank profile with absolutely nothing on it whatsoever, or when you click on the thing to view profile, it comes up and says this content isn't available. That's what I do anytime anybody contacts me about anything. I look at their Facebook page, and if I see anything suspicious about it, then I generally don't even answer them. And I think those text me at blah blah blah, I can pick up tomorrow, that's some kind of identity theft scam. They just want your personal information so they can use it against you. And then I get all of the ones that hit the is this still available response, even though the first line in my ad says if you're still seeing this ad, it's still available, and I do not answer to the is this still available scammers and time wasters. If you want to buy my item, send me a real message. But yeah, like I said, try not to get on too big of a rant about the idiots on Facebook Marketplace. But yeah, this is, you know, I kind of like the looks of this. It is better than some of what they put out, but they could have gone a few steps more. They could have also used a little bit more powerful amplifier in this thing too. That cartridge is also a little loose in its head shell, so I'm going to have to be careful with that. I'm going to wind up having to glue that back in one day. But yeah, there it is. I always wondered what one of these was all about, and now we know. I'm pretty sure the deal with some of the Crosley models that have magnetic cartridges is in response to all the people who were whining and moaning about the horrible ceramic cartridges. So Crosley just responded by sticking magnetic cartridges in a preamp stage in their record players. Well, I hate to tell you, Crosley, but there's more to one. There's more to making a good record player than putting a magnetic cartridge in it. When you put a magnetic cartridge in it and fall short in other areas, then you're really no better off. And it's like I said earlier, it is possible to make a decent portable record player with a ceramic cartridge in it. It's all about designing the proper amplifier and proper speakers and that sort of thing. I mean, they had no problem doing it back in the 50s and 60s, so they should be able to do it today. Actually, it's like I've said before, they could design a portable record player today that is just as good, if not better, than some of the old ones that we love, but they're not going to do it because that would drive the price up to the point where your average China Mart shopper would just walk away from it. You know, in today's world, it's not about quality anymore. It's about just give me the lowest possible price, and when I get tired of it in 6 months, or when it breaks in 6 months, I'll just go buy another one and be done with it. Whereas 50, 60, 70 years ago, people demanded quality, and if they bought a radio or record player or TV or whatever, you know, that sucker better last for years. Because if it didn't, you'd have an irate customer on your hands. I mean, yes, the old stuff often required periodic servicing, but at least it could be fixed, unlike some of this junk they make now. Alright, so I guess that's about all I've got for this. Still hasn't rained yet. This may be one of those things where it just gets dark and the wind blows and makes you think it's going to rain and then nothing happens. Alright, I'm done for now. More to come later.